Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke, Dogumentary TV. Today is Sunday. I believe it's June 11th. I am privileged and honored to have Mike Sottile. Well, he's part of the family that originally brought the Cane Corso to America. There's a lot of controversy, I guess, surrounding the breed, depending on who you talk to about the breed. So for me, you know, this is Dogumentary TV. We want to document and get you guys the real. So we're trying to go to the source, and we're going to talk to Mike a little bit today. I'm going to ask him a bunch of questions, Corso, and the part that his family played in bringing it to the States, talk about the breed as it was back in Italy, and obviously the current state of the breed as he sees it. All right, guys, this here is Mike Sottile.
How you
doing? Introduce yourself.
Hello. How is everybody? Well, I'm Mike Sottile Jr. As in the video you saw, that was me next to my cousin, Corrado Della Pianta. We were at that particular video is at Cerebus Antico. That was a dog, that was a female, a nice female called Zara. That was in around the spring of 1992, if I believe correctly. It was around March or April. So we've been in the breed. Let me start from the beginning. My great grandfather immigrated to America, and he always had a few Italian mastiffs, but he didn't call them Neapolitan mastiffs because they weren't breed. They were called Cane Depressa. There was no distinction between a Neapolitan mastiff and a Cane Corso back when my father came here. He came here in the turn of the century, and my father got involved with the dogs as a little kid. He was involved taking care of his grandfather's dogs, and what happened was he got exposed to them through his grandfather, and they were just called Cane Depressa, or they were called Italian Bulldogs. You know, that was the slang in New York area for a mastiff from Italy. But the proper name was called Cane Depressa. Literally means the dog that grips. You know, what with the dogs, my father's interest was when he was a little kid back in the 30s and 40s, he had these dogs around him all the time. And as he got older, had a family, everything, my grandfather, great-grandfather got older. He wanted to get more dogs. He had remembered the dogs that his grandfather had. So in the 70s, he went and got Neapolitan Mastiffs. And he started a registry called the Neapolitan Mastiff Club of America. That was founded in 1973. And he ran that up until the time he passed away in the early 90s, around 1995. And then I took over till about 2003. And they were AKC recognized, so there wasn't really need for a registry after that. But we did get involved by chance, we got involved with the Cane Corsos back in 1988. My father was on a trip, a wedding in Sicily, and he saw some dogs out in the field that looked like the Neapolitan Mastiffs that he had originally gotten from Italy in the 70s, because it was as most people with the Mastiffs know, there was a great change in the dogs. They started getting more wrinkled, more bone. They started getting shorter, like more shorter on the leg, cobby, long and short, dwarfy kind of. But anyway, dogs that looked like the original dogs that he had from the 70s and that his grandfather had back in the 30s and 40s. He got the dogs. He ended up getting dogs from a farmer in Castelbuono, Sicily, Joshua Sardo. And we brought them over, and that was the beginning of the Cane Corso in America, was my father bringing them over. And he started a registry for them. And, you know, we went from there. You know, it's always been a passion with my family my grandfather, maybe 100 years. We passed down through the family. We've had this type of dog always.
All right. And Mike, let me interrupt you for a second. Give me an idea of what exactly was it, what work did the dog do back in Italy? How was the dog's temperament, characteristics, and I guess all around workability?
Well, it was always a dog used on a farm. It was used. It wasn't the glorious stories of the dogs working on estates and all that. Yeah, I'm sure there were, but mostly it was the poor man's dog. It was the farmer that had these dogs. They relied on these dogs to protect their livestock, to protect their farm, their equipment. They used them for herding cattle. They used them for herding sheep. They used them for catching wild boar, for hunting. It was like an all-purpose dog. I mean, they didn't have a lot of money, so they needed the dog to do many functions, you know, and these dogs fit the bill at the time. They were all strictly for working, and they really weren't for looks. They weren't show dogs back in the day. They were not. That's like something that came late, like in the early 90s, they became show dogs. But the thing was, they were always a working dog in Italy.
Right. So how would you describe the temperament of the breed as it existed back in that time?
It bonded with the immediate family, with a few family members, but it was very elusive to strangers. You couldn't approach a dog. If you went to approach a dog, you get bit. I mean, they weren't gonna out and out like attack you. They would warn you and let you know not to come any closer. You know, if you got out of your car, they would like keep you at your car. You weren't allowed to like walk the farm or walk anywhere. They would keep you right where you were standing. They wouldn't attack you, but if you advanced, the dog would nail you. You know, it was a dog that, and that was with zero training. That was with zero type of training. The dogs just instinctively, that's how they grow up. When they get to a certain age and you raise them around the farm, I guess it's a type of training, but not really a formal type of training that the farmer did for them. They were just naturally protective. Generation after generation, these dogs were used for that purpose. And if these dogs weren't suitable for that purpose, the farmers would dispatch or cull out those dogs and not keep them in a program. You know,
right.
Today's standards, people would freak out. You know, oh my God, you put a dog to sleep because it didn't work. But yeah, these people without these dogs, they couldn't survive.
Right. Let me ask you this. So in terms of these dogs working, did they work in groups? Were they a single dog, or were they able to, you know, work in a pack?
Well, it depends. Like on the farm, usually they would work in with, like you saw in the video, there was some Maremma sheepdogs, Pastore Bruzzese in Italian. Usually what happened was they would have a combination of the sheepdogs that actually went out with the sheep, out in the field. Those were the sheepdogs. But the dogs, and then when they bring the sheep into their farm, like they would take them out to eat, like out in the land, and then they would bring the dogs back, the sheep back in at night, and they would lock them in like a fenced-in area. And that's when they let the Corsos out, and the Corsos were responsible for protecting the area, the farm. I mean, the sheepdogs were there, but they used them in unison with each other.
And I'm saying, when you say they would let the Corso out, would they let out one or two, one Corso, two Corsos, three Corsos, or was one Corso enough to kind of guard a pen of sheep?
You broke up. I didn't understand that question.
So at night when they let them out, was it like one Corso and the sheepdogs, or did they have
No, sometimes they would let out two, three dogs, you know.
Okay.
They let two, three dogs out, and maybe whatever they had, a few sheepdogs running the herd. But yeah, and then during the day, we'd chain them back up because the Corsos weren't like they were too valuable to lose. They didn't let them go out like roam with the sheepdogs during the day unless they were present with the dogs, with the sheep.
Right. And at night, what exactly was the were the the Corso protecting the sheep from? Was it predators, well, human predators?
From people, all human predators, you know, people looking to steal, people looking to take things. From wolves at night. That's why they brought them back into a walled area, so they didn't have to worry about the wolves like coming into like grabbing the young sheep. But yeah, they were basically like the first string in protection at night.
Okay, give me an idea what the size of these dogs were back in the day. Like how much was a fully grown male in terms of height and weight?
Well. I mean, it varied because, to tell you the truth, the farmers didn't have a standard for the dog. They used they bred the dog by tradition, and the way the dog was always like a certain look. But the dogs could range anywhere from 100 pounds to like 140 pounds, say. And that wasn't right. Like a fat weight. That was like a... the dog was healthy, but the dog wasn't like obese like they are today. They were solid.
Right. So just talk about the fact that, you know, that you said at this time that we're talking about, or we're speaking on, there are no kennel club standards basically ruling over the breeding programs of these farmers. And so these farmers were basically breeding based on the productivity of their breeding stock. And how did that affect the quality of the dogs in terms of their workability, the predictability of their temperaments, and their overall health?
Are you talking about now or like 30 years ago?
I'm talking about back before, not now, but back in the 30s, 40s, and 50s.
Okay, well, breeders were... The breeders were mostly all farmers. So there was variation in type with the dogs because what used to happen with the Corsos were, they used to have, like I told you, they were called Cane Depresses before they were ever called Neapolitan Mastiffs. And actually, it's kind of word semantics for a Corso and a Neo back in the 50s because they were the same dog at the same time. Is this that 1-1 AKC? It's kind of like the Amstaffs and the Pit Bulls, like when they first began. They all came from a Pit Bull, but they some chose to register with AKC. It's the same thing with the Neos and the Corsos. Back in the day, they were all the same breed. They were all the same purpose. What they did was they bred these dogs. The form followed function with them. It was the dogs had a certain look to them because they needed, the dogs were mastiffy looking. What they did was back in long time ago, what they used to do when they used to have the dogs, they used to breed the sheep dogs into the Cane Depresso. Okay. The Cane Depresso, the pure mastiffs that they had. And they made a Cane Corso, and then they would take the Cane Corso and they would breed it to whatever percentage mastiff they had in their breed. But every farmer had a different percentage of what they thought they needed. Some might have it more mastiffy looking. Some might have it a little more, the coat might be more thicker, like a Maremma sheepdog. But they were all Corsos. But there was no standard back then. It was just what the farmer thought they needed. And whatever worked for that farmer, that's the look. And that's what he was happy with, and that's what he went with. As long as the dogs did the purpose that he wanted, that's the way they looked. You know, there's no standard.
Right.
To tell you the truth, when they bred them, they certainly had a look to them that you could tell when you saw them, oh, that's a Cane Corso. Because, I mean, it was obvious what they were.
Right. What about any other, like, extracurricular activities? Was there any dog fighting going on back then?
Well, yeah. There was, that's like a major thing. Up until, say, when Enchi started when SAC started pushing for registration with ENCHI and FCI for the Cane Corso, tradition was that they always fought the dogs. They fought the dogs on, like, say, a Sunday. And they basically, just like a pit bull, they rolled them. And they, you know, they bet money and they had matches with the dogs. And that was part of their culture. Like it or not, that was part of the culture of the dog. They used to fight the dogs, you know, right, just like they do here.
Right, but they never bred for the dog to be a better fighter. They always bred for the dog to be a better farm dog, correct?
Well, I mean, it depends on who you talk to, but there was some dogs that were better than others, and people that were into fighting the dogs more than others, they probably seeked out the local dogs that had a name, that were winning the matches or winning the fights for them. So they probably it wasn't natural selection after that. They were seeking out the winners. They were looking for a superior. If they fought the dogs, they breed to the one that had the name, the one that was winning.
Right. All the time. None of the Cane Depressa and the Depressa Canario, is there any connection there? If we're going back before the kennel clubs came together, or before they begin engaging in the
a lot of people get that confused. To tell you the truth, back in the late 80s, early 90s, there was a lot of Corso or Cane Depressa, depending on your word semantics, that got sent over to Spain, got sent over to the Canary Islands. And if you talk to an old timer, an old Spaniard that bred presses, he'll tell you that there's a lot of Mastino, meaning Mastiff, Neapolitan Mastiff, in the Depressa Canario. At sometimes, the Italians, sometimes they're not very, their integrity isn't very high. They would sell breeding a Corso, a Presa, and maybe a Pitbull will come out of the same litter. It'd be three different breeds. So
right,
it got very confusing real quick because they were looking to make money. So maybe some Corsos went as Presas, some Presas went as Corsos. I don't know. I mean, they were looking to make money. These guys didn't have a lot of money, and then they saw when they got popular, they started mass producing these dogs so they could make a little extra money.
So, right.
I mean, yeah. But
all right. So in regards to what we're going to call the pre-American existence of the breed, is there anything else you want us to know about the Cane Depressa as it existed in Italy before we move toward to what's going on today in the United States?
Existed as it existed 30 years ago. Well, the dogs that we brought. Well,
you're breaking up on me.
Yeah, you're breaking up to me too. Well, 30 years ago, the dog was a different dog. Well, the dogs that we imported were Cane Corso. They were a Mastiff type dog. The dogs that are now in the AKC ring, the last 15 years, the Italians have been crossbreeding boxers and bull mastiffs and borbles into Cane Depressa, Corso, Neo type dogs. And they've been throwing papers on the dogs, and they've been mass producing and sending them to all over Europe and all over America. And I mean, you could see it in the show rings. Dogs are not what they were 30 years ago. They're boxer hybrids. They're mongrels. I mean, the most winning, a three-time world champion from like 10 years ago, 15, 12 years ago, I want to say, a dog named Champion Chino. This dog was a boxer cross in Italy. This dog was a three-time world champion, and you could look at the dog and see that he was a boxer mix. So it's very political, and a lot of people are new in the breed. People get in, get out, and they don't realize that a Corso is not supposed to, because they have no frame of reference or knowledge, because they're they're novices in the breed, and they believe that those Corsos they have in their kennel are Corsos. Those are not Corsos. Those are all mongrels that are in the show ring, the boxer crosses. I mean, it's gotten to the point where the papers were all, they hang papers on everything. And it doesn't matter because it's all boxers that they're breeding in crossbreds. I mean, it's getting to the point where there's no Corso in the Corso anymore, in these AKC and IPF dogs.
What was the initial purpose? What were the people who actually introduced and started doing the crossbreeding? What was their point for doing that? What were they trying to improve or change about the Corso?
They wanted to soften temperament because these dogs are very aggressive. A Neapolitan Mastiff or a Corso are they're very protective of their family. And the boxer is a little soft, in my opinion anyway, being around Mastiffs. And they wanted to create something different than the Neo. They didn't want to be associated with the Neo, so they made an undershot dog. The dog was never, of course, there was never an undershot dog. They made the dog an undershot dog because they wanted to make their differentiate themselves from the Neapolitan Mastiff, which is supposed to have a scissor bite. I mean, but now all these dogs have undershot bites. A lot of them have undershot bites, and that's not how a Corso is supposed to look. A Corso isn't supposed to have an undershot mouth.
All right.
You know, I mean, it's a big mess. I mean, the show people don't care, but me being a person who's come from the original dogs and my family had them, it's kind of like a disgrace. I mean, the dogs are not what they are. To me, the dogs that have been with the papers, the AKC papers, they're not even Cane Corsos. They're mongrels.
Right.
And they know they're mongrels, but they don't care because they have papers. They do that. You know, they're fake papers.
Right,
right. They're not Corsos.
Right, right. So in regards to the dogs today, aside from the temperament, I guess temperament would be a big difference. What else do you see? What other issues do you have with the modern Cane Corso? We call them the modern Cane Corso, as it is in the show ring. I mean, obviously dogs, you know, all dogs are going to change. I mean, the Dobermans aren't what Dobermans used to be.
But the problem is there's a lot of dogs that are from the original dogs that came over 30 years ago, and nobody mixed them into the new lines that came over. So there's 30% of the dogs still look original, and 70% of them look like boxers. The problems that they're having now with the new school dogs that they brought over, that they're breeding, is epilepsy. Dogs are having temperament problems where the dogs are very soft. I mean, the dogs are very small. I mean, now they're producing white Cane Corsos. Where did white come from? There's no white in the breed. Maybe 500 years ago you had piebald mastiffs, but the white, what dog comes in white? A boxer, a disqualification boxer comes in white. So, I mean, dogs have got white all over their face. I mean, the dogs that my family brought over were solid colored dogs. They didn't even have white on their toes. I mean, they're solid color. I mean,
right.
Now they're bringing dogs in that are white with, they're bringing them piebald dogs. I mean, how is that possible? I mean, I understand evolution, but evolution doesn't change in 30 years.
Right, of course not, of course not. So let's talk about the dogs that you have then, because you still, you stuck with the original blood that your father, with the original blood that came from Italy. So, you know, just give me an idea of what's different about your dogs. And also let me make a note that there's a guy out here in Riverside, his name is Jimmy. He has some of your dogs. I will be going to, I believe sometime or the following week, I will be doing a documentary with Jimmy. He has some of your original blood and I don't know if you've seen these dogs in person or you've seen pictures of them, but give us an idea of the dogs that Jimmy has and like the dogs that you have to this day.
Well, the dogs that Jimmy has is the dogs that I have to this day. I mean, there's no difference. It's the same line of bloodline that we brought over, just downline 20, 30 years. Jimmy has dogs that are from the original breedings. There's no boxer cross, no nothing. Jimmy was fortunate enough to get into a line of breeders that had stuff originally from that I sold and my father sold to them in California. And these dogs are cookie cutting just like the old dogs did 25, 30 years ago. And if you look at my dog, I only have a few dogs. I have one Corso male in my house. And you look at Jimmy's dogs, it's the same. I mean, there's no boxerati, boxoid type dogs in Jimmy's dogs. He has a pure line of Cane Corso, Cane Depressa, and that comes directly downline from my family's original dogs that we brought over 30 years ago. So it'll be a good treat. It'll be a nice treat for you to see a real Cane Corso in a couple weeks.
Well, I'm looking forward to that. So far, we've kind of dealt with the history of the breed, understanding where the original Cane Depressa started, where it came from, the work it did, how it looked, how much it weighed, the introduction of the breed, your family introducing the breed to the United States, the changes that were made. And you're saying that the changes that were made in terms of the introduction of Boxer, Bull, Master, Borbo, that was pretty much done by Italian breeders in Italy. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And by all the Italian, I mean, the certain show crowd that wanted to mass produce their dogs. You know, I mean, it's a tragedy what happened, but that's what happened. And anybody that'll tell you the truth, those dogs are, all the dogs in the last 15 years have the boxer infusion of them. And there's only a few dedicated breeders to actually run the old original Cane Corso, rustic, authentic Cane Corso. Those other dogs are not Corsos. Those are mongrels. I mean, they could say whatever they want on the papers. But, I mean, they're not Corsos. They're like Don Machete, Mr. Hernandez, Derek Mattson. Those breeders have authentic. They kept the old bloodlines. Jimmy, a few of Jimmy's friends have pure dogs. And I mean, there's others, but I can't think off the top of my head everybody in the country. But everybody that has a pure Corso has dogs from those people. And those dogs are originally from the stuff that my father brought over.
Right. Now, Have you taken any of your grievances to the AKC or any other the kennel clubs and try to find some sort of recourse or resolution to these issues?
No, because you know what? If they were so concerned, about it, they wouldn't. I mean, it's pretty obvious that these dogs are not. These are not. It's not the same breed. You know, I don't think the AKC is concerned about the look. They're concerned about the money coming in on the registrations. I mean, FCI accepted them. So if FCI accepted them, what's AKC? AKC is going to go with whatever FCI says. You know, FCI fraud first, and then AKC took over for America with the dogs. And I mean, it's a fraud. I mean, these dogs are not the dogs that are. I won't say that all. There might be like 8 people that have 80% my bloodline, 20% old, new school stuff. There might be people that have, but the vast majority of them have contaminated the bloodline so much that you can't make it back into the original stuff anymore. It's impossible. You know, it's too much contamination of boxer.
I guess, blood alive any strategies where you're going to make sure that these blood doesn't disappear?
Oh yeah. In fact, I've decided with myself. I mean, there's some people that want to still show AKC. I don't discourage anybody with the original stuff. They can do whatever they want with their dogs, you know, show wise. But I've started. My father had a registry for the Neapolitan Mastiffs. I started it up again, called the Neapolitan Mastiff Club of America, and I started registering Cane Corsos and people that breed old school looking Neos that are more like a Corso. I started registering them into my registry, and I'm trying to preserve the old rustic Cane Corso. So, which are, it's word semantics, it's the same dog. But I'm trying, there's a small group of us that are trying to preserve the old style dogs. And we're scattered from New York to Pennsylvania to California to Florida, but we're trying. I mean, it's hard because it's like us against the world, but we're trying to keep the old look.
Right. And in addition to keeping the old look, are you guys placing these dogs in any kind of working environments so that, you know, so that maybe farmers can begin to spread the word about the utility of the original Cane Depressor?
Oh, yeah. Well, there's some people that actually that are doing hog cat, like they go out and catch hogs with them. Some people are actually using them for like sheep herding. They're like having their temperament tested for sheep herding. Some people are actually using them for herding. Not many. I won't say many, but there's a few. And a lot of people are still using them for a shutzon and for personal protection work. You know, that's what the dogs were intended for, to work. The working dogs. They were never intended for the show ring. The show ring was just a way to the publicize the dogs to get them out there to the public. But it was never intended to make them into a show dog.
Right. Well, I will say this: if you know of anybody that's using original Cane Depressor blood on a farm, if you could put me in contact with them, that would be kind of the kind of documentary that I would like to produce. So, if you know of anybody, no matter where they are, I mean, if they're far from where I am right now, it may not happen soon. But if I can find them, if I can get the resources, I put together on that.
Okay, well, I will say there are still a handful of Italian breeders that do use them for that purpose. They haven't all gone boxerati on us. There's a handful of breeders that still have the authentic rustic dogs, and they do use them for like the old days, like I was explaining in the beginning of the video. But there's a few people that use Corsos in America, like Jimmy's he's about to go hog catching with his male. He's gonna go out in the woods and catch hogs probably in a couple weeks.
Okay. So,
I used to catch hogs. But now I'm getting old, and I don't feel like walking through the swamps.
These are catch dogs. They're not like bay animals, right? They're not just barking. They actually bring the hog down.
They strictly catch. They don't bay. The type of dogs that just go in there and grab the ear, and that's it. And they're not gonna bark. They're gonna grab whatever they run up to.
Okay. All right. Well, we're coming close to the end of this, I believe. Can you tell me, is there anything else that you want us to know that we haven't talked about yet today?
Well, what I want to say is there's a lot of passionate people about this breed. They're not all – some of these people really are very passionate about saving this breed. And I like to shout out to a few people if I can. Saladin Salam, he's very passionate about getting – publicizing the history of the breed and getting everyone educated.
Let me stop you for a second real quick. Yeah, Saladin, I couldn't think of his name, but he was the very first person to to mention you to me, and this was probably maybe a couple years ago, 2 years ago. He was very much, he hit me up and was very persistent and insistent that I reach out to you, that I talk to you.
Yeah.
At that time in my head, my idea was that I only wanted to do interviews. I had to come to where you were and actually film your dogs, film your yard. And obviously that wasn't able to happen, but, you know, because of Saladin, and Saladin is always in my Facebook group, posting content and information about the Cane Corso, the Neapolitan Mastiffs. So he is definitely a good dude. He's definitely, I want to give him props for being the first person to mention you to me. And, you know, because I wasn't able to get to you in physical form, and actually, you know, I didn't have the resources to come and film with you in where you are, I still felt that it was important that, you know, since I was starting to do this live stream, that at least the audience got to hear you speak and, you know, just kind of hear from you firsthand. But I still, at some point, because what Dogumentary TV is about producing documentaries and not just about these live streams. At some point, I still want to come to where you are and sit down with you and do some filming.
Okay. Well, you're more than welcome. You know, I mean, but the whole thing is, I just want people to know that the Cane Corso, there's a few people out here that still breed the authentic Cane Corsos, and it's hard to educate everybody because people are stubborn, and the dog show people don't want us to talk because then the dog show people don't even know the history of the breed that they say they own, you know. So that's the problem right there. They're just looking to make a $2,000 sale real quick and then be on your way. They're not looking to educate people. You know, I feel you have a responsibility. If you have this breed, you have to educate people. It doesn't seem like a puppy sale. You have to educate people so they can go on and educate people, because I can't reach everyone on earth if I don't teach people about the history and about the dogs and the temperament. Then who else? I mean, it has to spread, you know. People have to be able to teach other people. I can't teach everybody on earth, you know. But I'm trying to do my best to get the word out there that there is still an authentic, rustic Cane Corso, and it's alive and well in America.
I stopped you doing your shout-outs. Did you want to mention some more people before we go?
Just Jimmy. Jimmy's a good friend of mine, and he has some fantastic dogs, and I really can't wait for you to see his dogs. You're going to be really impressed with his dogs when you see them. And, you know, that's all really I have to say. I don't want to be like try to or anything. It's about the dog.
Right.
That's
right.
All it's about. It's about the dog.
All right, well, cool. I'm going to look at my calendar right now and tell you exactly when I'm going to film. I believe it's June 25th is Jimmy. Yeah, so June 25th, that's a Sunday. So there's a couple of Sundays from today, two Sundays to be exact. So that means that week, probably around the 30th or maybe July 1st, there should be a video out. So I'm looking forward to it as well. Jimmy, I talked to Jimmy on the phone a couple of times. He's very excited. He had me pumped up. He's pulling out all the stops. He's going to, he's actually having some of the other dogs to come off your blood from Arizona come in on the 25th. So we're going to have a good representation of the males and females from your blood. In addition, he's going to have, I think he's going to have his trainer. They're actually going to show the dogs, his dogs that are working in protection training. He's going to do some of that, demonstrate some of that for me. So I think it's going to be a great video, and important for people to understand that there's a world bigger than the show ring. One of the things that I would like to say to my audience is that a lot of times I see a lot of comments on this on my channel in regards to a dog having papers, and when I talk to own dogs, work dogs, use dogs for a living, and as a part of their life, I would probably say all of them care very little about papers. I'm looking forward to seeing your dogs. I'm looking forward to seeing what the original Cane Corso looks like and is. I want to thank you for taking the time to on a Sunday to sit down and talk with me. I appreciate it. I'm sure my audience appreciates it. This video will be up on my channel for forever, I guess, for as long as YouTube is around. And hopefully, you know, the message that you gave today will live forever and be shared amongst thousands of people.
Thank you, sir.
All right, man. You have a great day with your family. I'm about to go in there and love up on my kids. And I will see you. I will talk to you soon. And I definitely will talk to you before I go see Jimmy.
Okay. Thank you. And have a good day. And God bless.
God bless, man. All right, guys. That's it. This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. I want to thank my sponsor, Evolve, grain-free dog food. I'm going to put the link to this stuff in the in the description box, you guys, to check it out if you need to buy some treats for your dog. I mean, this is a great treat. It's a healthy treat. My dog absolutely loves them. So I say that these are good for you, and I'm actually happy that they are supporting the channel and help me produce this content. You guys have a wonderful day. It's Sunday. Should all take a second and appreciate all that you have. All right, guys. Peace.